Hi everyone, Stjepan here. In today's video, I'm going to continue the series on the dubious openings with the most dubious opening of them all, the Irish Gambit, also known as the Chicago Gambit. This opening is completely insane. It's just mental, and White is lost by force after he plays it. I'm going to show you how. Also, at the end of the video, I'm going to show you what White can do to make the position interesting and why this gambit can sometimes succeed. So what are we talking about? We are talking about the position you can see on the board in which White can play the Roy Lopez, White can play the Italian, White can play, I don't know, knight c3. But White plays knight takes e5. Now this is very similar to the Halloween gambit, which starts knight c3, knight f6, and then knight takes e5. And the idea is the same. After black captures, White expands with d4 and gets play. Well, you can find the video on the Halloween gambit on the channel. In the Irish or the Chicago gambit, White takes the pawn all the same, and of course Black needs to take this. Now, I'm covering this from Black's perspective because I would like to give you enough knowledge to be able to refute this opening every time you face it. So, here is what we do. We take the knight, of course. Now, here's a fun fact. This opening is known as the Chicago Gambit because Harold Meyer Phillips, who was a famous American player at the time, used it in 1899 in a simul in Chicago to beat Harry Nelson Pillsbury. I'm going to show you that game. Pillsbury was one of the strongest players alive at the time. So, White is going to play d4. And there's no doubt about that. There's basically no other sensible move to complicate the position. Now, in the game we are going to see Pillsbury, and another game I'm going to show you, Black played the knight back to c6. And here is the issue. White can expand with d5 with tempo. Now this is still incredibly winning for Black. But after knight e5, f4 comes, and now it gets tricky. After knight g6, there are a ton of pieces already in play. Queen f3 can be played, and these pawns are rolling forward. These pieces are, for the moment, insignificant. These are not. So this could get interesting. Let me give you a quick antidote against this. You play knight g6, and now there are no tempi. Now there are no tricks, and I find working on this playlist incredibly fun, and I'm actually going to use some of these gambits myself, even though they are completely ridiculous, but at least I'll have something to fight my friend who likes crazy openings. Anyway, here there are a couple of attempts for White. They all lose because you played knight g6. Basically, this knight defends your king. It's very hard to lose a position when the knight defends so many squares. Also, it will take White at least two moves to challenge this knight. So we are going to be looking at c4, f4, and knight c3. All moves are, all three are incredibly bad. Also bishop c4. Bishop c4 seems like the most interesting and the most forcing, and looks at f7, it's interesting, but here is the antidote. Against bishop c4, you play d5, and this may seem counterintuitive, but I did my research on the opening, and d5 is an incredibly strong move. Many of us would be scared to give up a pawn like this and keep the bishop on this diagonal, but here's the point. Once the bishop takes, of course, you play knight f6, and this is the critical line. This is what I believe most people who play this gambit would play. Now, the bishop simply has to retreat. If White allows you to exchange this bishop, then he is lost without any compensation and, more importantly, any tricks. So bishop b3. And now you may be scared to take this pawn because of queen e2 and stuff like that, but you can take this pawn. Knight takes e4. After queen e2, you play queen e7, similar to other openings we've covered. And White is going to castle. You can play knight back to d6, challenging the queen. Again, if the queens are traded off, then nothing. So queen d1. And here you simply play queen f6, getting away from rook e1. And that's it. This position is busted. White has no attack. White has only one piece developed, fine, and the rook. So, for example, after something like c4, you can play bishop e7. And knight c3, you castle kingside, and White resigns. So the most obvious move, the most aggressive move, which prepares to bring the rook in the game and puts pressure on f7, simply fails to d5. That's simple. Now, after c4, which is another incredibly aggressive move, establishing this very strong center, again, a simple antidote. I tried to make the refutation of this opening incredibly simple, and I think it is. Against c4, you play bishop b4. And that's it. White doesn't have a c pawn to block. He has to trade off one of the pieces. And after, for example, knight c3, if bishop d2, you take it. If knight c3, you play knight f6. And this pawn advance means nothing. And it's just a winning position. Why? Because if this happens, then you can play knight e4. And on your next move, you're going to castle. If white does nothing to defend this pawn, then you're simply going to take it. Again, a winning position. Now, visually, the most aggressive move is f4, preparing to dislodge this knight, also bringing the queen to f3. Now, again, a simple antidote, the simplest of them all. You play d5, and after d5, if white exchanges, that's it. So he has to play e5, keep some tension in the position. And now again, a beautiful move, bishop f5. And you activated your piece. Bishop c4 is impossible. Bishop b5 is met with c6. Bishop d3 is met with trading bishops. Bishop e2 is too passive, considering that he gave up a piece. You could also play bishop e4 after that. So the most aggressive move, g4, which you may be thinking of, simply fails to queen h4, and you pick up this pawn and dislodge the king. So I don't know what to suggest. Probably knight c3 is the most sensible move. But now again, you play bishop b5, and let's say bishop d3. You don't even have to trade. You can play queen d7, castle queenside, and just checkmate white. So that's it. And one more move, which I would like to look at, is knight c3. Oh, excuse me, we did that. Yeah, bishop b4. So it's really easy to refute this. Okay, let's go over it again. So after knight takes e5, white plays d4, and you play knight to g6, and white resigns. Against bishop c4, you play d5. Against c4, you play bishop b4 check. Against f4, you play d5. And against knight c3, bishop b4. And did we do this? Wow, my mind isn't working. Okay, anyway, after knight c3, bishop d3, you again play d5 and then break the center. And if white castles, then you can play knight e7 and keep your center under control. This is not an issue at all. Knight d5, knight d5, e d5, queen d5, and you have bishop e6 and bishop e7, and white is busted. Now, let's have a look at this position from white's perspective. I'm actually going to flip this board. Okay, so how does white win these positions? Well, this is the game Phillips played against Pillsbury. And after knight takes e5, Phillips played d4. Pillsbury played knight c6. And now, the second game I was able to find is a game between Fais Bojan and Shripko Ljubomir, which I'm guessing was a blitz game. They are 2400 rated players. That game went knight c3. We are going to have a look at that as well. In this one, Phillips simply played the move d5. Now, in the game, Pillsbury went knight b8, which is way too passive. And of course, if knight e5, we saw that, then f4 and the position gets tricky. But it's still the move you have to play, because you want this knight on g6. After knight b8, here's what happened. Bishop d3, a very sensible move. d6, a normal move. And white castles. So white is not in a rush. White just, well, put his king to safety, and he's preparing to push his pawns, and either with c4 or with f4, or both. So knight d7, c4, which probably isn't a good move after knight d7, bishop e7, and knight c3. He wanted to get his pawn out of the way first. Knight e5 blocking the position, bishop e2 declining the trade. So he's playing as if he has all of his pieces. And f5. F5 is too tricky. Here's my advice. Against this gambit, and against most gambits, don't play aggressively until you've consolidated your position and until you've developed your pieces. So f5, it's not such a bad move in itself, but it opens up the lines towards your king. A great response from Phillips. He just plays f4, and the knight has to drop back. Now the bishop goes back to d3, f takes e4, knight takes e4, and bishop f5 played, trying to trade off some pieces, and now he even finds time for king h1, which was unnecessary, but he wants to play g4, and here, just briefly, bishop e4, bishop e4, knight f6, bishop f3, again saving his piece, castles, and g4. Now it gets pretty hard to play black. All of his pieces are on the first two rows. White has this very strong bishop pair with this bishop on c2 and the other bishop maybe coming to d4. And Pillsbury plays a5, which has nothing to do with the position. Rook f3, the rook prepares to go to h3. And now the pieces are coming in. So from this position on, I would say practical chances are equal. Even though white is a piece down, black managed to complicate the position so much that he is now practically in trouble. The a3, he wants to play b4, but I mean, he should be doing something else. Also, Pillsbury can just play a5. Rook f7, defending h7, b4. The knight drops back, and now bishop to d2, and the bishop is going to c3, if that's allowed. Also, maybe he was trying to defend the pawn, but I doubt it. Queen e8, and this is the final blunder. So after queen e8, white is winning. Here is why. He gets the rook into the game with tempo, and after rook e7, he just exchanges. Takes on f5, g takes f5, and queen takes f5, and this is now indefensible completely. So that's the famous game the Gambit was named after. The other game, which was played in 2009, so about 110 years later, went knight c3. And this is fun. I think most people would expect d5. Knight c3 is a nice move. Bishop b4, sensible. Bishop c4, knight g7, both sides castle, and now knight d5. And white trades off pieces, despite being a piece down. So here, and e takes, and the knight has to drop back. The bishop goes to g5, h6 is played, which is a loose move. I mean, h6 does not have to be played. Probably d6 is just better. You can play f6 if... why d6? Well, firstly, you open up your bishop, and you block this diagonal. So if, for example, rook e1, then you can just play f6, and there's no d6 in the position. But h6, okay. The bishop drops back, and now c6, which is... c6 helps open up this diagonal. He should have played d6 again. But c6, queen e2, g5, and again, does the same mistake that Pillsbury did. I'm a piece up, I should be playing aggressively. No, you're a piece up, you need to play solidly, you need to consolidate, you need to make sure there is absolutely no play around your king. That's priority number one. Only after your king is perfectly safe should you do something. Also c6, just ridiculous. But basically after g5, it's tricky to play black's position. White is still losing, of course, but g5 is a weakening move. Allows f4, allows h4, undermining the structure. So here's what happened. Black grabbed this pawn. White exchanged, c takes d5, and white played f4. And now, how relevant is the bishop on c8 for the moment? I mean, and the rook on a8. d6 played finally. c3 taking time to dislodge the bishop. Bishop a5, and now fg. hg. Of course, if queen g, then bishop f4 could be tricky. Queen h5, and visually, this doesn't seem nice. Here's the thing I would like to highlight. White is actually not a piece down at all. This bishop on a5 is out of the game, so the material is equal. Okay, king g7, h4, perfect. f5, another dubious move. Hg, rook h8, and now simply queen e2, and he keeps declining trades. Black keeps trying to offer trades, and eventually he just gets a lost position. In this position, either black's flag fell or he resigned, but it's, by this point, it's extremely hard to play black. Of course, he's still a piece up, but this bishop is pinned. And I think the engine says this position is equal, but practically speaking, I mean, you're a rook down, and these bishops are not doing anything. So White can try to complicate things as much as possible. Now again, against this move, here's my advice once more. Make sure your king is safe. Don't move the pawns around your king. And most importantly, after knight takes e5, d4, play knight g6. Not knight c6. Play knight g6. And you will be fine. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know what you think. And stay tuned for more chess. Bye-bye.